Hello everyone, my name is Sylphalon, and welcome to Gaming Lounge. I have with me again, the game dev Chris.
Hey!
How are you doing, Chris?
I'm doing good, how are you?
Great, great. So every journey is a series of choices. The first is to begin the journey. And I thought, this time, after Chris is showing off his skills in the Mario Maker editor, I thought about showing him something that his mind might get crazy about.
Especially after we just did Please Don't Push Anything on GDPG, and we had our brains melted. Seemed appropriate to play another brain-melting puzzle game.
Yeah, definitely.
So should I just jump in here?
Yeah, sure, jump in, jump.
Leap of faith. Let's
yeah,
jump into jump. Well, let's do the jump thing. Okay. Oh, great. Oh, no. All right.
Disco!
So, wow.
All these, just as a side note, all these things exactly, failing to succeed does not mean failing to progress.
Interesting.
So, all these little things give you little hints about what's happening.
Okay. And that's, I think that's a really good first message to tell the player too, because it kind of sets the precedence for the rest of the entire game. Choice doesn't matter if the outcome is the same. Thanks.
Yes. So what now?
Okay, well then what happens if I go backward?
Aha. Whoa!
When you this return to where you have been, things aren't always as remembered. Oh, okay, so they're basically saying, yeah, you did exactly what you were supposed to do.
Whoa. Exactly, but how, if you think about going forward, how would you ever think about going backwards to get somewhere new?
It's true. I mean, that's like, that's pretty classic for games, right? Like,
you think? Okay.
I think it's a lot, it's very popular in a lot of like maze-like games, you know, where, I mean, have you ever played Zelda, like Ocarina of Time?
Yeah.
It's like the, oh, interesting. It's like the Lost Maze where, you know, there's always at least one section where you have to go backward, because it's like every time it, I guess I'm doing a bad job explaining it, but like, I don't know, I think it's a pretty common puzzle mechanic. This always messes with my head. I feel like I've been seeing this kind of thing happen in games a lot more often lately, where it'll like generate a path underneath you.
Okay.
And really the only time I have issues with it is when they, like, say, okay, say like they generated this path, right? And they put like random gaps in it, but it's generating so close to my feet that it's really hard to anticipate where the gaps are.
Oh.
And so suddenly the challenge becomes like, how do I step carefully so I don't fall, but also get the path to generate so I can continue forward? Oh God. Whoa. Oh. Whoa.
If you would jump down just directly on it.
Like right now?
Yeah.
What? Oh, like, oh, whoa, okay, so it just, like...
Yeah, was... but you have to have momentum, right?
Yeah,
put some weight
I didn't
on.
Catch that. Dig a little deeper and you might find something new. That's exactly what I just did. Unless...
Yeah. Unless... <No.
laughs> What
Let's
the fuck?
Go through!
Oh... Alright. Well then. That's the thing that happened.
Jesus. As you've seen in the beginning, there have been just two, three different mechanics, like going back to find something new, then this pressure played, and this room, where you look from a different angle, you see something completely different, you're thinking like, okay, how this can physically be all in the same space.
Mm-hmm.
But now you've seen so many rooms, and you think like, okay, there's so many rooms, so many things that I've already seen, what have I not seen? I need to go back.
Oh.
Exactly, and then you're through. You're somewhere else.
Whoa. Yeah, that's kind of the thing with these types of games too, is that it's like, oftentimes you find puzzle games and it's sort of like a one-trick pony where, you know, they throw one thing at you that you really don't expect and then they kind of like reuse it until it's like, okay, well, this is no longer interesting because you sort of just like used all your best ideas right away. This game, I feel like I've heard so many great things about it, so I guess my expectation is that they do a great job at continuing to invent new ways to introduce different types of puzzles to the player, but I guess I have yet to find out. Oh.
You noticed the arrow. I am impressed.
I'm gonna guess.
Yep. However.
Oh, I see. So do I have to...
Yep. Yeah, I have to go
back. That's clever. So you've played this game. Have you beaten this game? Like,
no.
Played all the way through? No?
I have not. After about 2 hours in, I was still running around in rooms that you're currently seeing because I felt like I've missed something somewhere and I'm running around. So there is, if you look over there behind the window.
This thing?
The other way. Through the window. Through the other window.
Oh, I see.
Exactly. If you look through there, a little bit, So there is a weapon.
Oh.
Sort of thing. Which does something. Okay, I don't want to give it away, but it does something. But finding it and getting there is not easy.
Yeah, so I went through this zone backward because it gets so dark. Moving forward, you actually can't see anything, but if you stare at the little glowing circle, you actually get a little bit of sense of direction, and you can see like when you hit a wall, so then you can move left and right.
Okay. Arrow. So how do you like the aesthetic so far?
Oh, I think it's stunning. I think their use of color is probably one of the best things they have going on for them. And like from an art perspective, it's actually... Ooh, I'm closer. From an art perspective, it's actually pretty clever because they don't have to ever worry about making textures for... Whoa. Life isn't about getting to the end. they don't have to make textures for anything, right? Like, I guess technically this grid is a texture. But other than that, like, most of these walls are just, like, flat polygons with some, like, vector coloring or probably, like, color shaders on them. Yeah, I guess I don't know how they would have done the gradient so much. I imagine that was some sort of shader. But either way, it allows them to focus more on building out interesting levels rather than making everything highly detailed like something like Portal would be.
Are you getting somewhere?
I feel like no. So maybe this isn't...
I feel
isn't...
like trying the same thing in this game over and over again is the one thing I didn't do. Because you pretty much know very quickly that if one thing doesn't work, it just doesn't work.
Right.
You've done this before.
Oh, here we go. There we go.
Exactly.
Yeah, buddy.
There you go.
What does it do? What am I doing?
So there's a left and a right click mode.
Is there? Whoa.
And actually, the game tells you on the wall.
Oh, I see.
And you stood at the door and the door was closed. What did you try to do?
You mean like walk backward through it?
No.
Oh, wait.
Up. Yeah!
Wow, yeah. I feel like a dope. That was a little bit more... That was probably one of the more obvious puzzles that I just totally just blanked on.
But it's interesting how... There is a very obvious puzzle at some point, and you're already starting to think way more complicated than necessary.
Oh yeah, that's part of like, oh wow, that was cool. That's part of like the glamour of it, I think, is that, you know, if you get your players in a certain mindset, suddenly you can start messing with them in ways that they least expected. Did you, I feel like I remember you mentioning that you had some questions queued up for...
Yeah. Well, currently, so you're currently working on Mario Maker a lot, and I asked you before whether or not you're thinking about making videos, designing something where you think players are already familiar with the game.
Mm-hmm.
Are you planning on doing something like that?
Oh yeah, I think so many of our episodes right now have been. Oh, I am stupid. I know what I need to do. The same thing I did earlier. But yes,
yeah.
Basically, now that we've had a bunch of episodes that kind of focus on like how to teach your player how to do this thing that you are, you know, designing your levels for, I think now Intangible and I can start focusing on doing a little bit crazier stuff. We're still sort of experimenting with the Mario Maker series. Did I just screw myself?
I think you did, yeah. I think you pretty much did. Wow. I didn't... I didn't think that was possible.
Well, oh, then. Jesus. Yeah, I like this a lot, actually. Because not only does it make it easy to kind of go back when you made mistakes, but now we can just go around to a bunch of different things.
Interestingly, have you seen the first room just now?
Oh yeah. Are these all these must be all the ones that I've checked.
Yes, but what I meant was the first room you went to, Leap of Faith. So now it says WTF.
Oh, okay, wait, this is sort of... We passed this at one point again.
Oh, yeah, we did. No, it was... maybe it was the one underneath that, interestingly.
Whoa.
What is the difference in doing something for players? I mean, there are obviously games around that are aimed at players who are already familiar with the game or with the gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
How's that different to designing a game than if you just... consider your player a total noob?
Well, I mean, we kind of see a lot of that stuff in games that have sequels, right? Because it's like, the assumption, I guess, is that the existing player base... Is there a third one? No.
Take the other one.
Yep. I am a dope. There
yes!
we go. Wow, so simple.
Actually, it kind of is sometimes. If you figure it out, you're like, oh yeah, right, that makes sense. It's...
Ooh.
But then you think, the next one, I'm going to get this.
Right? But yeah, oh, it opened that door behind me too. But
so
yeah.
how is it different?
So if you're building a game with the expectation that the player already understands how the game works, I guess you can generally make things a little bit more advanced to begin with, but no matter what, I guess like a game is generally going to introduce more complicated mechanics if that is the case. So no matter what, there's going to be some level of teaching your player how to... I don't know if I
want to. Do you want to?
I'm gonna do it. Oh God, why? Oh. Man, they really chose a good way of making it unsettling.
Is it a bird? Is it a damn plane? No, it is. Ah.
You know, it's a great thing there's no falling damage in this game.
Yeah.
Really, when it comes down to it, it doesn't change a ton.
Okay.
Because I think no matter what, there's going to be some level of teaching your player how to play your game.
Okay.
And if you're not introducing new or more challenging mechanics as you build the game, then I think you really have to ask the question of, is your game interesting enough?
Let me give you a hint. There is no limit on the cubes you can have at once.
Oh, shoot. I guess, I don't know why I assumed that I could only carry one at a time.
For a very simple appearance of a game as this, I find that the gun suddenly looks very, very detailed.
You know, I would agree. I think actually a large part of that is because it's one of the few things in this game so far that have rounded edges.
Oh, right.
It is still kind of polygonal, so you can see some hard lines on it, but it's very circular in an angular world.
Okay. Do you think this game introduces you to new mechanics that are progressively getting harder? Or do you think they're all as hard as they can be?
I think the gun certainly switches things up a lot. I think, so the way it kind of is set up is there's, generally games have a, like a, what's it called? It's like sort of a difficulty flow, but it's also sort of like an engagement flow where it kind of like, it peaks, it increases, right? It starts really low and then it gets higher and higher until it kind of peaks out and then it dips down a little bit, but it still is like higher than the original starting like engagement level, I guess is one way to describe it. Well, I guess I didn't need to worry about that.
Nope.
And so what happens is basically it ebbs and flows until it always is constantly increasing. And so like right when we got the gun was probably where the engagement peak just like it just had its peak and sort of started over, right? So it went back to that low point, and then after that they could introduce, you know, new things, new types of puzzles that the gun can be incorporated in. And so now that we have the gun, the difficulty is slowly increasing until we get to the next big thing, and then it's going to drop back down and then slowly increase as we kind of figure out how things work. I feel like this thing is going to explode. Ah! Is this just here to mess with me?
Well, I'm not going to say.
No. There's more to this.
You know, always taking the right riddles at the right point for the right person is something that I feel is really, really hard to hit.
I completely agree. And especially like 3D puzzle games are both one of the most difficult types of puzzles to make. But in turn, it's also one of the more difficult puzzles to play and figure out. And I think that's why the Portal games were so successful, was because like they did it right. They really figured out how to make those puzzles engaging and not be overly difficult.
Exactly, because they made one little step each chamber, and they only had the one portal gun, and it was always you go through that portal and you come out the other end.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you have some gels which change things up a little, but you still have to use the portals to distribute the gel and get anywhere. Have you ever created a game with riddles?
Not riddles.
Or a riddle-focused one?
I've certainly made my fair share of puzzle games. Back when I was in school, I worked on a very interesting 3D... It was sort of a 3D puzzle game. Basically, the concept was you have a sphere, and we've actually seen a few... I wonder if I can find a good example in... I think it was in this room. No, it wasn't in this room. Wait, maybe. It looked something kind of like this, actually, believe it or not, where it's like you have this sphere that rotates, and you have these kind of little narrow platforms, and it was like sort of a puzzle in that you had to navigate a little like laser beam across those little like circle pieces and find a way to like disarm the device. And if you ever... if the laser fell off of one of those little platforms, the thing would blow up and you would get a game over. So it was sort of like a solve this puzzle as quick as possible kind of thing. So it was sort of a skill-based puzzle, which it was very interesting to design. Unfortunately, we never released it because I think our programmer kind of dipped out toward the end, but he also got a real people job, so I don't really blame him.
A real people's job?
Yeah, he got a job at WayForward, and so it was like, well, you got a job working at a legitimate game studio. I can't really hold that against you since we were making just like weird iPhone games at that point.
No, you can't.
I really wonder why they included a time remaining in this game.
I don't know. I mean, I can't really tell.
Right, like maybe it was sort of a method of making the game feel stressful enough to kind of like, I don't know,
get somewhere.
Yeah, I guess maybe they felt that the game wasn't challenging enough on its own, And okay. I kind of get that, but at the same time, I actually don't think it's appropriate for this game, because it's already interesting enough on its own that I don't think it needs that stress factor to make it satisfying to beat.
Well, other than that, the only thing you can do is beat the game, but you cannot lose the game if you don't have a timer, right?
Right.
So there is nothing that prevents you from taking all the time in the world, and does it make it a game if you can't win or lose?
Well, that's the question, right? I think that the lose scenario in this game, if there was no time, was the player giving up.
Okay.
Because that's how it is in most puzzle games, right? Like, I don't think that I don't think that's so so wrong to like kind of get meta about it and say like the game over scenario is giving up, because I think that's totally fair.
Okay. The game scenario is giving up. The game's losing scenario. Okay. Not sure how many people would accept that.
Yeah, I guess that's sort of a it might be an unpopular opinion, but I like to design games that are more about the experience rather than about the challenge.
Okay.
And so I think this game would completely survive as kind of that same sort of concept.
Ooh, you're getting...
You know, we'll make this even easier. I'll do this. Yeah. Yeah.
You're getting creative.
Well, I mean, they gave me the means of doing it. I've also noticed that, I've noticed that most of these other zones have that little barrier that removes your cubes as soon as you... Ah, shit. Well...
Goodbye, cubes.
I could climb up here with these cubes, but
oh,
I don't think I will.
Oh, you can get the cubes. Right, right, right. It doesn't matter how far they are away.
That's kind of nice.
Yeah, it is. I mean, that also implies that you will at some point have to use that option.
You know, that is totally possible. I feel like if they made me climb a huge wall like this, that would be kind of a cruddy thing to expect a player to do,
because it
would take so long.
Yeah, and you're not exploring anything new. You're doing the same thing over and over and over again until you are on the top.
Exactly. Whoa.
Speaking of designing anything, are you working on something currently?
A few things, actually.
Okay.
Anything
worth talking about?
Well, I think... I don't remember if I mentioned this last time. I did a recorded with you. I don't know if I mentioned the golem fishing game, which was that little silly adventure game.
I think you did, yeah.
That one's actually, we kind of put that one on hold. Oh, I think the stairs go up. But they do. But anyway, so I've been working on a game with one of my programmer friend, actually, that works at WayForward. He and I are working on a game. I probably shouldn't mention that, actually, because...
No.
But...
That's okay.
It's fine.
It's fine. Nobody watches this video anyway.
Oh. But we're working on a little...
Now you gotta give me a like, folks. Now you gotta give me a like. Just as well, okay, for showing off that you've seen this video.
Oh, I always do.
Yeah.
So we're working on a little mobile game called Fish Slap, which is it's a super super silly game, but it kind of plays on classic D&D tropes of like, you know, monsters, and we kind of put them in a silly setting. And have you ever played Infinity Blade? It was a very popular mobile game.
No, I didn't. I'm not playing too many mobile games. Most of them. Turn me off by having a very, very annoying business model.
I generally agree. I tend to not play very many mobile games, too. I'm very fond of Infinity Blade, though, because it did something very different and new, especially, like, not even just for mobile games, but for games in general. And it basically had the concept of fighting in a first-person perspective. Dang it. Maybe I shouldn't be trying to go up this way. But basically, the concept was you are some sort of, you know, melee fighter. You have like a sword or something, and you're presented this you know, big monster, and he takes up most of the screen. And the way you interact with the game is you just swipe left and right, and, you know, tap to dodge and things like that. And okay. It's sort of like a what's that game called?
Cut the Rope.
It's kind of like Punch Out, right? Where
Punch Out. Oh yeah.
You're evading certain attacks, and then you're, you know, striking when the opportunity is given to you, and it really like gave it a very modern design, and I thought it was absolutely interesting and fantastic. And so, Fish Slap is sort of inspired by this similar type of design, where that's the way we expect the player to interact with the game, is to have that kind of combat. But we're making it a little bit more adventure-y and a little bit more comical, and, I mean, you're fighting with a fish as your primary weapon, and you're going around and basically slapping a bunch of classic D&D monsters wearing fancy clothes, because you're...
Magikarp! Go, you splash!
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what it is. And you're in, a fancy mansion, like an 1860s, like, London mansion. And so all the D&D monsters, we have, like, a beholder wearing a top hat and wearing a bow tie. Or, like, you know, like a displacer beast wearing, like, a dog collar and, like, acting like a hunting dog. It's just, like, a bunch of goofy little stuff like that. I probably rambled a bit on that, but that's basically the main game I'm working on right now. And then Intangible has started up another project where he and one of our... I don't know if you've interacted with Harry Poppins.
No.
But his real name is Nick. And he's been kind of on and off with... Nah, I'm not worried.
Nah,
damn. But he's actually been on GDPG before. He and I have been doing a playthrough of The Curious Expedition. And he's probably one of the best writers that I know. And so he's finally starting to dab his feet into game design. So he and Intangible are actually working on making a game. And then... They're right now in the paper prototype stage, so it's very, very early on. But the hope is that if it's good, then they'll get a programmer, or we'll recruit a programmer and actually make it a full-fledged thing. But it's a very, very ambitious project.
Oh, it is. Do you at least know the genre?
It's a turn-based strategy. Have you ever played Final Fantasy Tactics?
Final Fantasy Tactics? Yeah, I was never the Final Fantasy fan. Sorry, folks. I take the blame on me. But Final Fantasy Tactics was, in fact, really interesting.
I think Intangible will argue any day that is one of the most well-designed games you could get.
Really?
Yes, he is a fanatic about it.
Okay. We should certainly have a deeper conversation about that. However, I have two more questions. First, is there any indie game right now out there, or not yet out there, which you're looking forward to see?
Well, there is an indie game that I'm excited to play that I recently purchased, and that's Undertale.
Undertale, okay.
If you haven't heard about it, it is...
I heard about it, but I haven't really looked into it yet.
It's one of the most well-received games ever in a very long time. I think it got a lot of hype because it recently surpassed the Metacritic score for Half-Life 2 as one of the best games ever made.
Okay.
Yeah, it kind of blew my mind when I heard that. And when I first saw it, I was like, okay, well, this looks fun, but it's, you know, it just seems kind of like another RPG.
It just, I just turned up the Steam page on it, and I actually had it open a couple days ago, and I thought, oh, this is a joke. Overwhelmingly positive, my ladies and gentlemen. 18,122 reviews.
And it's considered exceptionally well made for multiple. Oh wow, this keeps going. Okay, whew, made it. Finally did it, guys. Yeah. So it's considered exceptionally well made for a lot of reasons, and I think one of the big things that it uses is it's a great example of a game that really uses surprise and wonderment. Like, oh. Well, that's unfortunate. To probably, like, the best ability that I've ever really seen.
Okay.
So much so that there are secrets so deep that there is a subreddit dedicated to data mining the game.
What?
To find more secrets in the code.
Whoa. Okay.
It's crazy, but it's awesome that the fan base has gotten so nuts about it that they want to do that. And I think that's amazing. If I could ever make a game that does that, I will feel proud.
Still, if I see the pictures of Undertale, I still can say this is a game I will like, because I don't like the aesthetic so much. This is certainly not a game for me where I say, well, I'm going to play this for hours, maybe half an hour, and then take it off. But it says overwhelmingly positive.
Yeah.
And I actually, well, I put it in my wish list, okay? I put it in my wish list. I had a new wish list to put it back again, because I looked at the pictures again. I'm like, this can't be. This is 18,122 people can't actually be wrong, right?
Exactly. And that was the thing with me too, right? Like, I saw the aesthetic and I was like, okay, well, this looks fun. It just doesn't look like it's going to be, you know, the greatest thing ever made. And then, you know, when the rest of the internet was like, no, this is the greatest thing ever made, I was like, well, I guess I should give it a shot. And I watched a couple Let's Plays of it, and I was like, okay, I'm sold. Like, have
really?
All of my money.
Wow. Okay. I'm really glad that games, and this is actually my personal opinion as well, are getting a lot of attention for what they are and not what they look like.
Yes. I think part of that has actually to thank for the indie community, because
exactly.
I mean, don't get me wrong, the indie community still makes plenty of games that have absolutely stunning artwork,
yes,
but we also make plenty of games that don't.
Yeah, like Banner Saga is a great aesthetic.
Exactly. So I think there's kind of a movement, right, where we look at a lot of AAA games and we're like, man, these are absolutely beautiful, but the gameplay is just horrendous.
Look at Call of Duty, do the same thing over and over again.
Exactly.
I remember when they had the press release and they were like, you have a dog now. And you're like, wow, that's the new thing in Call of Duty.
That is kind of a misconception, though, I think, about a lot of indie games, is that people often assume that indie games are cheap to make. I recently saw a lot of backlash.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen... Oh, whoa. I don't know if you've seen that Tim Schafer, the guy that made Psychonauts, recently launched another Kickstarter for Psychonauts 2. And there was a lot of backlash because people were like, hey, Psychonauts is Double Fine is already making so much money, why would they do crowdfunding?
Use that money you got there. I mean, you got the crowdfunding first to get that one out, then you got people buying the game, and then use that money, please, to make up your new game.
But
the
thing is, I don't think that that's so wrong to do.
Okay.
Because it's at that point, it's literally no different than pre-ordering a game. No different. You know it's going to get made. You're just buying the game, you know, like a month or like 6 months ahead of its release, or, you know, a year ahead of its release. But all things considered, it's really not that different from a pre-order. And so that's kind of what upset me about people freaking out about it, because it's like, it's not bad. And asking for, you know, $3.3 million is a really a lot more reasonable than I think people think that it does. I think the misconception is that because so many indies make, you know, games on like a $6,000 budget, that, oh, games don't cost that much money to make. That's not true. Those $6,000 that those indie developers are asking for, that's rarely enough to ever make a game. They're probably eating nothing but ramen noodles during the entire development of that game and living at their parents' house because they can't afford to live anywhere else.
Probably, yeah.
So, like, really, the misconception is that the indies are asking for too little.
Anyway, do you have any final thoughts on Antichamber?
Well, my main thought is that...
I feel like you're kind of stuck in a loop, aren't you?
Yeah, well, I guess I'm sort of at that point where it's like, I don't want to waste people's time making them watch me, like, make it through this thing really slowly. Mm. But then I just didn't discover anything new, so I suppose I did the same thing either way. But my main thought right now is that I definitely plan on playing the rest of this because I'm fascinated. I knew I would be fascinated. I really should have played this game a lot sooner.
I feel like you're at a little bit off to where I got. I got, I think, a couple rooms further. Probably at the same time, but at some point, you know, I was doing the same thing. Running around in circles, coming across the same rooms over and over and over again, and getting to the same barriers where I thought, okay, what am I supposed to do here?
Mm-hmm. You know, I almost wonder, too, when they were designing this game, if they designed this with, like, you know, how can we just, like, mess with people's brains more than, like... You know, will people enjoy this? Maybe, maybe not. But if people like Portal, then they'll probably like, you know, style a puzzle like this.
Yes. And when you design a puzzle, everything needs to be on point for the puzzle to work.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You can't be off some points. You have to give the right hints. You have to lead the person to a certain place. If you feel like there is something invisible that will appear if he gets there, you have to lead him. Like, for example, this word fly. Okay, the word fly, what does it lead to? You jump off the cliff, probably, and think like, okay, you can fly because you already know that there is no falling damage in the game.
I mean,
when you get there.
Even the name of the room above where it says Crimea River, that says everything about it too, because it says fly, and you know, you fall, and maybe players will be like, oh, that's stupid, why would you make me do that? It's like, Crimea River, I'm teaching you how to play this game.
Yeah, exactly, and then, so even the title, every little single thing is exactly as planned. So that's why I think you can't put anything unnecessary in a game like this.
Yeah, I guess I should have gone this way sooner since I kind of knew.
Think that must be so confusing right now.
Oh, I see what I gotta do here.
Yeah, you can push it.
Well, anyway.
And now, woohoo!
Woo! Huh.
If you look up.
Oh.
So if you jump at the right moment, you can get there.
Interesting. Okay. That's kind of clever.
Well, anyway, it was nice talking to you.
Yeah, it was very nice talking to you too, and thanks for having me on your show again.
Yeah, of course, of course. Always welcome. And I hope you will finish the game at some point.
Oh, yes.
At some point. Tell me how it was, because I couldn't. I actually had to look it up, and I watched a speedrun type of video, because this game you can easily speedrun once you know everything.
That makes sense. I mean, that's kind of what I was sort of saying before too, is that once you figure it out, it's like, this is a lot more straightforward than you might have thought.
Especially there are no elements that require timing.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike in Portal 2, where you, for example, have to put on the portals and have to wait for the goo to fall through the portal and get somewhere, and then you can do something else.
Right.
You're not reliant on anything else. You're doing everything yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Can be as quickly as you can. All right. Then I hope everybody has a good night, good day, or whatever the time is. And thank you for being on the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Yeah, and see you next time.
Cool. See you, everybody.